In India, 50% of our population lives on less than $2 a day, and they have no access to any kind of public health system which can take care of them.
100 years after the first heart surgery, less than 20% of the world's population can afford it. For 80% of the world's population, if they ever require a heart operation, they're going to die.
You see a small child, mother is holding a child, and you tell them that there's a hole in the heart which needs to get fixed. The first question the mother asks in this country is, how much is it going to cost?
The patient and their family should be focused on the healing and the recovery and not having to worry about the finances.
Health City is a vision to change the way that healthcare is delivered and to provide the highest quality of healthcare at the lowest price to the largest number of people.
Anyone that doesn't believe that healthcare is being disrupted outside the boundaries of the U.S. is not watching what's happening in the Cayman Islands, and they're not watching what's happening in India.
We have to find ways of reducing cost. You can no longer spend 18 or 19% of your GDP on healthcare. It's unsustainable.
I believe that India will prove to the world that the wealth of the nation has nothing to do with the quality of healthcare. And once that happens in India, it will be very easy for other countries to follow. When I was in fifth standard, our teacher came to the class one day and announced that today somebody in Cape Town transplanted a human heart. And that's the day I decided that I want to become a doctor.
In your country, you have vehicular traffic jam. We have a human traffic jam.
Cardiac surgeon like me in this country, or most of the surgeons, our job has been reduced today to put the price tag on human life. As surgeons, we in India, when we are operating on these patients, we are also under tremendous pressure, because it's not the question of just getting it right. It is a question of the impact an accident can have on the family. It can be devastating. If a 50-year-old breadwinner of the family dies, the children and the wife will be on the street. There is no one to take care of them. There is no social security system. We need to do 2 million heart surgeries a year. And all the heart surgeons in the country put together perform only 120,000 heart surgeries. What happens to the rest? 1.9 million people die within the next few years because they couldn't afford the heart operation. And in the process, we perhaps produce one of the largest number of young widows in the world. It is a calamity.
In India, heart attack is a disease of the young breadwinners of the family. This is the social impact of one disease called heart disease. Now you add cancer, you add other diseases. You can imagine what havoc healthcare plays in the life of people living in developing countries where there is no social security to protect us.
So is that usually how you do it? You get dressed in the car?
Yes, 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 I do. Yeah, otherwise you have to... You'll spend some more time. Yeah, I always like to do two things at any given time. I hate doing one thing at a time. Just when I'm coming near the hospital, I remove my jock suits and t-shirts and wear the scrub suits.
I lead a fairly hectic life. I have a lot of things to be done on a given day. I see 60 to 80 patients every day. And a typical patient of mine is a little baby sitting on the mother's lap. I examine the kid and I tell the mother that her baby has a hole in the heart and he needs an open heart surgery. She has only one question: how much it is going to cost? When I tell her that it is going to cost 80,000 rupees, which she doesn't have, that is a price tag on the kid's life. Essentially, I'm telling her that you come up with 80,000 rupees, you can have the kid. If you don't have 80,000 rupees, you're going to lose the kid. This is what we do from morning till evening, putting price tag on human life. This is what all the doctors working in most countries do. Now, is it acceptable? It is not acceptable. Because I go home, I look at the comfort my children have. And what 80,000 rupees in our life is nothing. For us, if a solution is not affordable, it is not a solution. It's pointless talking about all the developments in healthcare if people can't afford it. Our strategy as a group is to reduce the cost of tertiary healthcare across the world, across the planet. We have managed to reduce the cost of a major heart operation in India to $1,400 from what it was around $3,000 25 years ago. It is not a cheap Indian way of doing it. Our hospital is accredited by Joint Commission of US. Our target is to do a major heart operation for $800. But the reality is that people simply can't afford to pay for the healthcare the way the cost is going up. Forget about poor countries, forget about developing countries, even the first world countries struggling.
The first question the mother asks in this country is, how much is it going to cost? They don't ask you what is going to be the growth of the child, whether it's going to be painful. They don't ask those questions. And some of them are even scared to ask the question as to what it is going to cost. They have empty look in their eyes. And when you see that day after day, you know something needs to be done.
This hospital started in the year 2000 by my father, and why he built his own hospital is that he spent a whole lifetime working in other people's hospitals. He would see close to 100 patients a day, but very few of them would come back the next day, and he'd wonder why that was. When he looked into it, he found that most people just couldn't afford to get heart surgery done. So in every institute that he joined and helped set up, he tried to create a culture of, you know, lowering costs, make it more affordable. But he could never have that flexibility till he started out on his own.
Our basic target audience is essentially middle to the bottom of the pyramid. And we work on a cross-subsidized model because we are not a charitable hospital. We are self-funded and we fund all our expansions of our own money. So we need to be sustainable. We need to be making a surplus to be able to invest it forward in putting up more and more hospitals. Today we have 26 hospitals across 16 cities. So the entire model of treating the poor comes from the people who can afford treatment. And if we are able to attract enough number of paying patients within our system, that helps us, you know, kind of take care of the poor. We do not turn away anybody. But to do that, we need to have paying patients, people who can afford to pay, to come to us and avail of our services. So the challenge is to market to them.
We have a great model. We have something that not a lot of people in India, or I would say anywhere else in the world, are looking at. And we use that to grow to 26 hospitals across India. You know, we've continuously challenged the cost paradigm in India. The cost of an open heart surgery in our group hasn't changed in the past 15 years, whereas the cost of everything else has gone up. So we want to keep pushing the envelope. And we started out at $3,000 for a heart surgery. Today it's $1,400. One day we'll make it $800.
when you restore a baby back to normalcy and you hand over that baby to a mother, oh, it's the greatest feeling. Because when you take that baby over from them, it's a huge responsibility. Because you do not know whether you're going to hand back a living baby. And when you can do that after a complex heart surgery, I mean, what greater joy than that?
How are you feeling? Good? You have your breakfast?
That has kept us going. And to date, not a single baby has been sent away for lack of money. And if we can say that honestly, and we wear that on our sleeve, I think it'll keep us going till as long as we can go.
What we have learned over the years is that high quality care, when the outcomes are good, it costs you less. The objective of technology should be to bring the cost down. If you see in any other industry, technology brings the cost down. But in healthcare, technology takes the cost up. I think that needs to change, and that can change only by a data-driven, facts-driven medicine, and where the decision-making process itself is supported by technology. I think that is going to be the quantum leap in medicine which is going to happen, and our group is completely focused on that.
People have a low opinion about commoditization of a service or a product. But Henry Ford proved that commoditization of a product makes it cheaper, makes it better, and makes it efficient. And that is what is required for delivering healthcare. Healthcare cannot be delivered as a handcrafted masterpiece. It is beautiful to have a handcrafted masterpiece, but how many people can afford it? If we have large operations, your results get better, your cost goes down, and when the cost goes, the results get better, your customers are happy and more people can afford it. So people may not like to hear the word commoditization of healthcare, but that is a reality. Sooner we embrace it, it's better for us. For us, healthcare is all about process, protocol, and price. And we can offer healthcare in any part of the world where every citizen can enjoy the beautiful things what healthcare can offer with dignity just by changing the process of delivering healthcare. And this is what we are trying to redefine. This is the mission of our institution.
I live for the ocean. It's how I'm rejuvenated. It's a part of who we are. We're an island, you know, we're surrounded by water. And that's what we live our lives based on, is the ocean.
I'm Gene Thompson. I'm a ninth generation Caymanian.
Love the Cayman Islands, great people, phenomenal people. We have about 125, 126 different nationalities here. It's a great place to live, great place to raise your children. Most of the larger companies on the island, all of the people that founded them were all seamen. My dad was a seaman. And you know, seamen are not known to be risk adverse.
I lost my dad due to the lack of adequate health care being available on the island. Very significant challenge back at that time.
I think there comes a point in time in life where, you know, your thought process matures and your value systems mature. And when this opportunity came up, to give back, to give people health, to give people back an opportunity to live, it actually grew pretty quick, especially when you get the spirit of Dr. Shetty with you and that whole, you know, that his vision and his drive. Welcome to Health City.
In the world that we live in, we have the cliche of saying that you get what you pay for. We don't believe that. We believe that you have to think creative and come up with radical thought processes. Health City is a joint venture between Narayana Hospitals and Ascension Health. You come to our hospital, you're not going to see granite and marble. We built this hospital with a home builder. Biggest thing he'd built is 16 apartments. And we had a support from a medium-sized healthcare provider out of Naples, Florida. You know, in the Western world, beds start at about $1 million and go up to $3 million. This hospital is $420,000 a bed, complete, including property, including everything. Every part of it has a value proposition, or every part of it has an impact on the deliverables.
Everybody okay?
My role is to deal with regulatory affairs, government interaction, local interaction, and then development of the project. We have 17 outpatient offices. And our model is very simple. There's no hierarchy. If you're our head of cardiology, or head of cardiac surgery, or a junior doctor, everybody gets the same size office and in the same area. We have a 17-bed ICU. We have 5 private rooms. We have 12 open bay rooms and 2 isolation rooms. This model is not a normal standard model that's used in the US. Over every ICU bed, we have natural light. And if you look at those silver racks, those are actually the nurse's station. They sit at the foot of the bed. Our operating rooms have windows to the outside, huge windows. That's another part of Dr. Shetty's model, that they believe that natural light allows the doctors to work better, more efficiently, longer period of time. Eight years ago, my dad had an aneurysm in his brain. And just because of the limited resources and limited availability of health care, by the time we got my dad to an institution that could have helped him, it was too late. We're not now offering neurological services or neurosurgery yet, but we have many heart patients. We have many people that, unless we were able to be able to handle their problem instantly, would have had significant damage or possibly loss of life.
Benoit, you back? Are you spending the night again?
Dr. Benoit is our head of cardiac surgery. He's one of the most prolific cardiac surgeons in the world. And he's here to implement this new system of health care.
Hello, good morning, Elsa.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm doing.
How are you?
It's good? Very good.
You have the lungs.
Okay.
Over the last 13 years, I've done more than 5,000 open heart surgeries. I was working in Dr. Shetty's hospital in Bangalore last 13 years. If every surgeon has an opportunity to work with a mentor like Dr. Shetty, this whole healthcare will change. I cannot still understand why healthcare is so expensive here. There's no need. I met one doctor here in the government hospital here. He spent $200,000 in US for his coronary bypass surgery that we are doing for $45,000. And I'm telling you, there is absolutely no difference, I can tell you. Because now coronary artery bypass surgery or any heart surgery, all over the world, most of the centers, it's all standardized. It's nothing big. So why something can be done $45,000 here is $200 somewhere different. Somewhere it's very difficult to understand. There's something wrong. So we have to find out what is that wrong and how can you rectify.
This lady has kids, she has a husband, she has a family. She's able to have this care, stay at home, and in addition to that, for about a quarter to a third of what it would have cost if she was sent off for the care. That's what it comes down to, saving lives, touching people's lives.
I'm Osborne Bodden. I'm the Minister of Health, sports, youth, and culture for the Cayman Islands. Culture is something I'm very passionate about because it's a chance for me to preserve and ensure that we take care of our Caymanian traditional culture and our evolving culture. Health insurance is mandatory in these islands, so everyone is encouraged to have insurance. We have a local government insurance company called Cineco, which has worked very hard at coming up with arrangements with various medical institutions in the U.S. to cap the cost and to manage those risks. So we look carefully at cases before they're referred overseas, and then we channel them to where we think the best care can be obtained.
Cineco stands for Cayman Islands National Insurance Company, and we are owned exclusively by the Cayman Islands government. Whilst we're a government-owned company, for lack of a better word, I don't think we want to see the government managing this pool of risk. We'd rather than make a health insurance company manage this pool of risk, and the government then subsidize or factor in what it needs to keep the pool balanced on itself. When I assumed the role of CEO at Cineco, at that point I met the CIO, the Chief Information Officer, Dale Saunders, who was at the Cayman Islands Health Services Authority. And we started the collaboration of implementing the system and kind of looking at what we as the insurer needed out of it, what he as the Health Services Authority needed from the system. And during our collaboration on that system, we didn't recognize some of the challenges of the entire healthcare system as a whole.
My name's Dale Saunders. I'm a healthcare executive in the U.S. and former chief information officer for the National Health System in the Cayman Islands. The Cayman Islands healthcare system is kind of a combination of the best parts of a Canadian healthcare system, a U.S. healthcare system, and a United Kingdom healthcare system. The federal government here in the Cayman Islands subsidizes and they encourage healthcare delivery and innovation, but they don't tell the CEO, Lizette Yearwood, of the Health Services Authority, how to go about that.
Healthcare here in the Cayman Islands has really come a long way in the last 50 years. We were a very, very small hospital, and we have learnt a lot of things as we have grown. And the Health Service Authority really welcomed Health City when they came to the Cayman Islands. There was a little bit of a learning curve for the local population and for the local doctors as well. They thought that this could possibly be a threat for their book of business. And Dr. Shetty and his team met with myself and a number of the senior leaders and other managers as well to understand what were the regulatory requirements here in the Cayman Islands.
I think it's safe to say that the Cayman Islands have never shunned away from risk. We saw the value. We actually made amendments to the laws and regulations to allow them to have their doctors come here and practice.
We had focus groups for the better part of 2 years. We saw over 3,000 people in those focus groups in settings of as many as 10 to as many as 50 to 100. We signed our first MOU, on the 18th of October, 2009. That agreement, through back and forth with government, negotiations with government, required the changing of 9 laws and 13 regulations.
We've actually been operational probably just over 3 months. I get somebody coming into this hospital almost once every 2 days who wants to know what we're doing. Maybe 150 to 200 physicians have actually inquired about whether they could actually join us.
So all of these different players coming together in a very selfless and collaborative way saying, how do we make this system work for the Cayman Islands? How do we make it work for the Caribbean? And how do we make it work for the US?
I think we're probably one of the first hospitals in the world that will publish our price as a bundled flat rate. And that's what you'll pay. Nothing more, nothing less. It's unbelievable. We tell them it's flat rate, here's the price, pay your check and it's done. And it's very, very amazing to them because they know that we'll send no other bills.
We have a single bundled price, which includes the hospital care, the surgeon anesthesia fees, or any other fees that need to be included, and that's exactly what the patient would pay.
You can't just say we're going to provide inexpensive doctors or we're going to, you know, provide inexpensive medication or whatever.